He has scaled 22 peaks. He's done 9 high altitude treks, 105 hill forts, 85 rock pinnacles, French, Italian, and Slovenian Alps. I'd kept the best for the last. Rajesh Gadgil. It'll be a pleasure listening to Rajesh. And when we are talking of GR, it's only appropriate that we have a highly experienced personality like Rajesh to deliver.
Good evening, friends, and I hope I'm not testing your patience too far. But there are certain aspects which are, in a sense, not covered in this whole day's discussions, and there are certain aspects which are covered multiple times. I haven't brought any presentation, fortunately. Otherwise, I would be just repeating what was said throughout the day. But I still believe there are certain things which needs to be addressed even after so much of discussion, so much of learned views. As I am told that I am to represent the non-commercial sector of the activity. I really don't know the differentiation. When you are talking about a common law for everybody, there can't be any sectorial bisect. Whatever is applicable to any one of you is applicable to me. So commercial, non-commercial is, let's keep that aside for the time being. Of course, there are certain, I would say, limitations or more limitations to a non-profit making organization in case of implementing certain norms or accepting certain regulations. But from a safety point of view, I personally don't believe that it is much different than what the commercial operator might be going through. The other part of my brief was whether this GR is actually hampering the spirit of adventure. To be very frank, my initial reaction was yes. When I first heard that such GR is going to come into existence due to a court order, not willingly, I was actually worried. And I believe that worry was shared by every one of us sitting here and even outside this auditorium. Because anything forced cannot be healthy, and that's, India is all about a democratic country. You can't force things here. They are not accepted. At the same time, there is a very important point which we are overlooking here if we think in that no mentality. What Shantanu brought to our notice, that the first talk of GR happened in 1997. Today we are talking in 2015. How much improvements we have ourselves made in our approach to our own activity. It's like, you know, it's like a school. Like, there are certain free periods when your teacher is absent. And if you make too much noise, then your PT teacher comes in. And which is not a very likable choice. Something similar has happened with this GR. Once we started deliberating on this GR, and once we started having different ideas and different views, slowly, slowly, my own view, my own perception changed. Changed from the point of acceptance that there has to be a regulation. Though I take mountains as my expression of freedom, it can't be taken literally when I'm taking somebody else with me. I still refuse to follow the government norms when I'm going to mountains alone. Alone in the sense, I am not responsible for anybody who is accompanying me. In that sense, I am alone. I really, really disagree with all the norms laid down in any format. I know I am an experienced guy. I know my companion is an experienced guy. And I know we both can deal with situations much better than any set norms. Fantastic. Over and above, we are responsible for our own lives. The moment I start taking somebody from the category Shantanu defined, that there is a novice, there is an apprentice, then my perception towards this GR or any regulation changes dramatically 180 degrees. There has to be a regulation. There has to be a norm. Unfortunately, what has happened is there is no dialogue between the, I would say, the industry in a larger sense, I would rather say the activity and the government. So there is no dialogue between, unfortunately, the regulators and the regulated, the rulers and the ruled. That's the most unfortunate thing. But rather than taking this as an, let's say, negative thing, I take this up as a challenge, or rather an opportunity. I live in a democratic country. I have certain rights. If I find there are certain things wrong with this GR, I have an option to go back to him and tell him, look, sir, I agree that there has to be a regulation, but this particular aspect is, you know, it is not healthy. It has a healthier alternative. It has something much better option available. Why don't we accept that? And let's keep this aside. It actually gives me an opportunity to go to my own government to tell them that I am interested in the betterment of my own activity, and there are certain methods by which we can do it, and we can do it together. It has given me an opportunity to make a dialogue by various means. I can send letters, I can go and ask for appointments, I can take delegations, I can meet my MLA, I can go to my MP, I can meet my minister. There are 110 ways to do it, provided I am confident of agreeing with what is good for me. And not just agreeing, but complying with it, which I think is the most difficult challenge to accept and implement. I will give you three examples. This can happen. I have seen it happening in last 6 months. No, I'm not talking a large time frame. One on national level, one on local level, and one on personal level. One, the satellite phone, which was the big bane of, or the big problem with foreign people or customers or even us mountaineers going to remote areas. They weren't allowed. Today morning we heard from Akshay that now the things are coming into place, and in maybe next few months we will be officially using sat phones. It has happened through dialogue. It has happened through persuasion. That law is still there, that you are still not allowed to use satellite phone indiscriminately. But in case of need, it will be available soon. Second is the example of the Canary Caves. Unfortunately, I believe Mr. Limay is not here. Otherwise, it was interesting to know from him what was government's perspective while closing down the activity which was running for more than 40 years without disturbing the ecology of National Park. One fine day, rock climbing was banned at Canary Caves. Everybody started discussing ways and means. Everybody put their own minds. Things happened. Ultimately, this was sorted through a dialogue with the forest department in Canary Caves. And today they have reached at the level saying that they are going to conduct rock climbing excursions for tourists, and we, the activists, are welcome to participate as instructors and will be paid to climb rocks. And this has come from government, our own government. Third is my personal experience. Last Christmas, this is 25th December 2014, I was at Pachmadi. Pachmadi is one of the, let's say, most beautiful place due to its jungles. Unfortunately, 2 years back, there are some 18 or 19 trekking routes in the jungles around Pachmadi. Except three, everything else was banned. No access. The bungalows were closed, everything else was closed. Fortunately, this time, there was a Pachmadi Mohotsav organized by MP government itself. We went, as I went with family. No adventure activity intended, pleasure trip. And there I just met the forest secretary and the tourism secretary together. And I simply asked them why, rather that tourism secretary was trying to make a dialogue saying that we want to develop Pachmadi and tourists are not coming the way they go to Jaipur or the way they go to Manali, why it's so, or even they go to Mahabaleshwar. I said, what's unique thing you have on offer? Why should I come here? What is the reason that I should come here? He said, okay, tell me why you are here. I said, because of the natural beauty, because of the jungles, because of trekking opportunities, which you have banned. So immediately he turned to the forest secretary asking him what can be done. The very next day they opened 3 trek routes more. Within 12 hours the decision was taken, the pamphlets were printed and stuck all over Pachmadi, inviting tourists to participate in trekking programs organized by forest department. And happened within one night. My only point is that rather than getting boggled down by this GR, it's our job to go back to the government again and again, as much time as it takes, saying that, look, your point number one is acceptable. Point number B has certain faults that needs to be, you know, changed, corrected, and point number C has no meaning in today's world. It should be altogether dropped. But unless we keep doing that dialogue, it is not just the non-profit making organizations or the commercial organizations, everybody else is going to suffer. There are certain backdrops to which Mukul also has pointed out, like there is no discrimination between, you know, categories of people undertaking the activity. It has to be made. The expertise is not there, unfortunately, and that is a fact, because government people are not trained in this particular area of activity. Fantastic. They are good lawmakers, they are good drafters. Can it be a possibility that experts from our field and experts from government sit together and draft something which is palatable, acceptable, and practicable to all, rather than just enforcing something which is not acceptable? So every Tom, Dick, and Harry comes up, goes to a court, files a writ saying that this is not agreeable, this is not agreeable, this is not agreeable. We actually will enter into a state of chaos. Third is public education. That point is not touched upon anywhere in this GR. Just placing one advertisement 3 cm by 5 cm before the trekking season saying that don't send your kids with unauthorized people is not education. What actually there is a fight or a dispute between what role government should play, facilitator or regulator. Somebody said, Mr. Chadda, I believe Colonel Chadda said that at this stage government has to be a regulator. Somebody from the fraternity said we look towards government more as a facilitator. That balance has to be acquired somewhere at this stage. Once you try to regulate something, first you will have to make sure whether enough facilities have been made available to effectively put those norms on. They are not there. There is not a single training institute in Maharashtra for any skill. Forget hard skill, forget soft skill. Not one single government recognized or government supported institute which has standard curriculum in outdoor activities. None. There is nothing. Whatever is happening is on happening on personal or the organizational initiative for their own people or maybe for some outsiders. Without having that, how you can tell me that I have to be at certain level? I don't agree with that. At the same time, it is my duty to point it out that look, if I am doing X activity, Y skill set is required. I need to point it out to the government, to them, as Shantanu said earlier. Mostly, I will say, current GR in the current form, in a sense, is going to hamper my activity because it is involving me more and more into a paperwork. I fear that they will make me a paper pusher. At the same time, keep your right hand on your heart and just say loudly that you, every one of you or any one of you, put everything down on paper which is minimum required as whatever your log, whatever your safety sheet, whatever your feedback form, whatever your report. How many of us do that? Definitely I don't do it. And I'm sure 99% people in this auditorium don't do it. So in a sense, I need to be a paper pusher because I don't keep logs, which is necessary for safety. Everybody, including Bhushan and all experts, have told us that. Government is making me do it. It's a welcome thing as a regulation. At the same time, I need to really discriminate which papers are necessary to fill. And only paper filling can't be a substitute to safety norms. This is a balance, and this is a very tricky balance that is ultimately based on knowledge. And as I said, it's dialogue, sharing the information.